We have conducted over 1,000 programs across multiple formats like workshops, panel discussions, seminars, and festival platforms, and connected with more than 125,000 individuals since our inception in 2009. In fact, this year we celebrate 10 years of programming. We focus on art, applied, visual, and performing, literature, culture and heritage, and innovation. Our curatorial focus includes presenting targeted discussions such as this one, and symposiums, workshops, roundtables, festival platforms, art exhibitions, walkthroughs, and much more. Our vision is to invite more people into the conversation about the arts and culture by deepening their multicultural learning experiences through sustained partnerships and by diversifying our programming to new spaces, formats, and approaches. As part of our programming, we have curated several successful series that engage with various aspects of the arts and culture. Multicolors Mumbai, as some of you know, is our best known and engages with our city and its numerous other daughters. The Kalagoda Art Series broke aspects of art and culture in the city, and another series that we are proud to have presented two successful runs of is our Beyond Contemporary Art Series, conceptualized by Ranjit Hoskote. Begun in 2015, we've had 8 robust episodes spanning 2 series. Each discussion was and is convened by Ranjit and continues to extend the invitation to respond to new developments and debates, revolutions and trends, preoccupations and passions of the globalized art world, and to reconsider the very fundamental role of art in the world we live in. Previous iterations of the series probe the condition of contemporary art through the lens of the curator, institution, artist, and viewer, and also looked at art as activism, art and technology, art education, and audience building. Beyond Contemporary Art Series 3 addresses topics like art as a political tool in the age of social media and information proliferation, which is today's topic, and art's evolution into a hybrid practice, the role of the artist as an environmental activist, and the updated performative, scientific, activist, and conceptual aspects of visual art. Today's panel is the second episode of the third edition. So welcome to BCA 3, Art and Politics in the Age of Information, presented by Art Musings and Avid Learning. This iteration is presented in conjunction with Art Musings Gallery's ongoing year-long exhibition, the 20th, curated by Ranjit Hoskote, that celebrates 2 decades of the gallery. I'd like to congratulate Art Musings on this landmark occasion and thank Sangeeta and her team for partnering with us to present these discussions right here at this lovely venue. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome our speakers for the evening, artist Ranjit Kandalgaonkar, cultural theorist Adajania, and our moderator, curator, poet, and cultural theorist Ranjit Hoskote. For more about each of our esteemed panelists, please refer to the bio handout that has been distributed. Please remember to take out your phones, put them on silent, and start using them. Get social by posting, reposting, and tagging. And Avid Learning and hashtag learning never stops. Thank you, and over to you, Ranjit.
Thank you, Sangeeta, and the team at Art Musings for this occasion and for creating these conditions where we can sit and have this series of ongoing discussions. And thank you all for braving the rain to be here this evening. What we thought we'd address today is a vexed question that has preoccupied artists, poets, philosophers, political activists, and so on for several thousand years, which is the relationship between artistic endeavor on the one hand, or poetics, and the practice of the political. And it's conventional in these situations to invoke Plato, no less, who in his ideal visualization of a polity, the Republic, decided that the poet, or more broadly the artist, did not belong there and was to be exiled from an ideal polity. That has partly to do with Plato's belief that artists only deal in secondhand experience, or that they deal only in shadows or imitations of larger realities. But you can't help thinking that what also underwrites that notion of banishing the artist from an ideal polity is the fact that artists speak very sharply and pertinently to all that is going wrong in collective life. And increasingly across the world, and certainly in the polity and society that we inhabit, it seems very clear that artists have a great deal to do in terms of confronting all that is in fact going wrong in our collective life. And for this occasion, I thought we would bring together two very articulate, very productive practices, speakers who come from the domains of art making and of curatorship, and who each of them has a hybrid practice, and I'll say more about that soon. Because these are people and practices for whom the political has always occupied a certain centrality, not to the exclusion of many other aspects of art making, but certainly as a condition and a predicament that deserves to be addressed and addressed continuously. So what I'm going to try, as I do try in this series, is not only to address abstract, unfleshed ideas, but also to try and get there through the particulars of practice, so to speak. So what I would always try and do when I'm speaking to people, this also is just my natural curiosity, is to draw people out on their own journeys and their practices and what brings them to these very central clarities from which they tend to work. So in the first part of what we are doing, to offer a brief roadmap, I'm going to do exactly that. Invite both Nancy and Ranjit here to... I should call you Kandalgaonkar. Otherwise, I have a mad idea that I'm speaking
unless
to myself.
You're talking.
No. But I will invite them to engage in brief memoirs of practice, so to speak, and then move on to questions that they've opened up and what they've said, and then at some point, of course, invite all of you to join in the conversation as well. So, Nancy, if I may, I'll begin with you. Since what we are doing today is really to foreground the political and how that informs both of your practices, I'm going to ask you about an early point of your trajectory, which really began with your preoccupation with the crafts. And by crafts here, of course, is meant not only the practices of the crafts, but also the inherent asymmetries through which we look at the craft. So could I invite you to talk about how your journey began in this particular context?
Yeah. Thank you, Ranjit, for convening this discussion. Thank you, Ranjit Square, for being part of this discussion, and also Sangeeta, of course, for hosting us here. And I'm very happy to be at Art Musings, of course. We all go back a long, very long way. And as for this discussion and its topic, I think it's good to start in a memoiristic manner, as you suggested, because whatever we do as artists, writers, curators, is always informed by our own biography, both intellectual and political. And therefore, in my case, I do not have a degree in art history, but I have a degree in the humanities. I studied political science at Elphinstone College. And I also have a degree in filmmaking and social communications media from Sophia's. So this is a kind of strange journey that I've had, a multi-pronged journey with many detours. And one part of that journey actually led me to the NCPA, at Nariman Point, where they had started the Moorcraft Center for Reviving the Crafts. And I was the founding programs coordinator there. And the idea was, you know, I mean, what can we do as our first program? And of course, because I was a political science student, I did not want to invite craftspersons and they would be sort of sitting there and giving live demonstrations, as was the norm at that time. It's a norm that actually started from the Festivals of India exhibitions into the 1990s, you know, continued by Rajiv Sethi and others. So the idea was, how does one actually bring in, you know, something which will politicize this whole discourse? And therefore, because one of my mentors, Shanta Gokhale, who was the editor of the arts pages of the Times of India, because she knew that my interests were about social justice and equity, she suggested the title, Should the Crafts Survive? Now this topic, Should the Crafts Survive, is a very interesting title that she gave. Because should the craft survive is, why should the craft survive? The crafts are dying, and if the children of these crafts of craftspersons' families want to do something else, they should be allowed to do that, right? Because we can't imprison them, you know, in some kind of a time warp, so that we can then indulge in our own fantasies about that which is primordial, or that, you know, or romanticize the crafts. But should the craft survive is also has this subjunctive quality to it. You know, if they were to survive, then what can we do? And that's where, you know, I mean, this was, I organized this whole national level symposium, and Shanta Gokhale told me, write a small note about it when you invite the speakers. Of course, even at that time, and Ranjit Square actually would concur with me, I'm a long play person, so I could not just write a small note. I wrote a whole position paper at that time. I was in my early 20s, and it was called The Mother Goddess on a Bicycle and Such Are the Themes. And this is where I started historicizing the whole relationship between the arts and the crafts for the first time. And I also started looking at the political economy of the crafts, because it's not just enough to talk about, you know, stylization or the locus of the crafts. It's also important to talk about, you know, I mean, what kind of programs were initiated by the five-year plans for the craftspersons. And that's how this whole position paper, you know, I mean, took shape. And I invited two craftspeople, Satyanarayan Lalkaran as well as Guru Pachetti, to inaugurate the symposium. So the idea was that they should be able to speak about what they feel could be done for the crafts in the future. And then, of course, it was Jitendra Jain and Rajiv Sethi. And then, you know, I mean, they had these contending views on stage, and there was, you know, quite a kind of a debate. You know, I mean, which brought two different points, two different approaches, and created a clash, very interesting discursive clash. And so this is how my journey began. You know, even before I wrote my arts and crafts essay for Art India, I had started doing field work in the crafts. And as I was doing field work and also reading people, of course, from the subaltern school, Ranjit Guha and others, but also reading Rustam Bharucha, who was writing about the question of the subaltern within theatre, I started realizing that it's just not enough, you know, to speak about the crafts in isolation. We have to be able to create the grounds for a discourse on the crafts and for the practice of the crafts to be politicized, to be able to take a new turn. And I was reading Rustam Bharucha at that time, and he started speaking about how if we of course should not be doing violence to the subaltern artists, right? But at the same time, we should not valorize them, because if we valorize them, then we are not able to look at the relationship between the self and the other in a critical manner. So I think this for me was my first forays into the crafts, but again, with this particular discursive underground that I was tapping into. And this discursive underground came from many different mentors. It would be Dashrath Patel, it would be Rustam Bharucha, it would be K.G. Subramaniam, it would be J. Swaminathan, it would be, of course, the Shantiniketan School, and, you know, I mean, to go back into history. So these were my starting points. All of these people who were my mentors, in a virtual as well as people who I actually knew, and then meeting people, you know, during my field work, like meeting Chitrakathi artists, for instance, like Ganpat Mazge. I mean, this was already the 1990s, you know, I mean, early 1990s, we all witnessed the destruction of the Babri Masjid, and of course also encountered the riots that followed it. But I mean, I now go into the interiors of Maharashtra, and I meet this Chitrakathi artist who tells me that, you know, there is no need to actually, you know, I mean, retell the Ramayana and Mahabharata only through these television series that we see at home. You know, there are other ways of telling the Ramayana and Mahabharata. So again, I could see that here was this Chitrakathi artist, Masge, who was giving a subaltern turn to the retelling of, you know, I mean, the Ramayana. And he had this absolutely beautiful story which he told me, because the Chitrakathi car is a picture you know, narration, they narrate the picture scrolls, the Chitrakathis. And while narrating, of course, you know, they're always, in a way, updating the retelling of the epics. And once he just told me this beautiful story about how Ram, you know, because Adobe told him that, you know, I mean, you can't really stay with you know, Sita since she's been kidnapped by Ravan, you know. So Ram just tells Lakshman, okay, you know, I mean, get rid of Sita, you know. So Lakshman is asked to take Sita to the edge of the forest. And of course, Lakshman, you know, can't get rid of Sita because he loves her, you know. And so you know, I mean, she's family for him. So what actually happens in this story, according to Maske, is that Lakshman goes to the Chitaris. You know, these are people who actually make these wooden fruits, you know, and wooden, you know, I mean, sort of, you know, I mean, domestic objects. And so he asked the Chitaris to make an arm, which would look exactly like a human arm. Because they could, you know, create this kind of verisimilitude because of their, you know, I mean, excellent skills and craftsmanship. And Lakshman took this arm, which was supposed to be Sita's arm, to Ram and said, okay, I mean, you know, I've finished the job, as it were. So this is how Masge brings in the Chitaris, you know, these people who make these wooden fruits. And then they also do this lacquer work. So you must have seen, I mean, at least in my generation, I remember mom buying these, you know, wooden fruits with this lacquer, you know, work on them, and they almost look like real fruits. So these Chitaris, so I mean, this whole subaltern group of the Chitaris, in a way, is inserted into this narrative, this hegemonic narrative of Hindutva by Maske. So these have been my experiences, and it is these experiences that I bring into the writing of art history. But I will talk about it.
As we said earlier, this is where you speak your name into the horn.
Yes.
As they used to be always. Okay, thank you very much for that, Max, because I'm going to bring some of those thoughts to you, Ranjit, because in the case of your practice, I'd like you to begin with, and I'm going to cite the work that you contributed to the Bergen Triennial, the Bergen Assembly, for its last edition. Haunting, elegiac, memorial, almost piece on the world of shipping, of the shipyard, veined very closely with family, childhood and family memories. So could I draw you out on your route into the world of art making, and what that has had to do with, you know, how that's influenced certain choices of subject, continuing fascinations?
Well, I started out as a telecom engineer. I graduated in 99. I worked in Andheri for 2 years, building radar fuses using PCB softwares and printed circuit board softwares. And then I went for my master's. And it was during that time that I was kind of reading about and knowing that there was a lot of change happening, because any major change of, like, you know, I'm the quintessential engineering kid that kind of goes abroad and then is not supposed to come back, you know, in that sense. And all my friends earlier who were going and coming, the city was never changing. But 2002 is this particular time in Bombay's timeline where the construction, where everything kind of exploded and changed in terms. So every time people went post 2002, there's a major change when somebody returned, you know. And I left in 2001, and when I came back in 2004, there was this kind of strange, different Bombay for the first time. At least this is what I felt, right? And I came back half with that idea that I wanted to document this change in the city. And I had not fallen into my practice as of yet, or what I would go on to kind of think of as my practice. But I was just keen on looking at certain aspects of how the city is changing. So I knew it would be something that I wanted to do over a longer period of time. So one of the things that I started doing was I started documenting walls. So there's a wall right next to Borivali Station, where I now live. There, I have been taking photographs of that wall for about 15 years now. And I still haven't I've made a work, but I still haven't updated it. So that work is called Hygiene. But that work started from documenting the first set of walls that were painted near Sasunda, just before Sasunda, that entire army, that the wall between Sasunda and Mumbai are from, right? That entire wall where Golden York used to be, everything. So that wall was, they started putting up these photographs of God to kind of prevent
tiles.
Yeah, tiles were put. And that started dealing with ideas of hygiene, starting dealing with ideas of invisible infrastructures and people that accessed spaces. And this was, for me, this kind of parallel ignored city, this parallel moving alongside. So then a couple of years later, I conceptualized city influx. So city influx as well as city influx. You know, the it's a play on essentially a migration as well as a constant change that is that's happening within people. And so these kind of mini projects became, I thought, would be kind of the central engine, which is my practice. And then I started looking, because I walk a lot, that I started looking at different things which are, that were happening. And yeah, so I, and then it went into areas of like looking at trusts, which was, no, actually before that, I was working with a couple of architects from Kamla Reja, and they were friends that I've always hung out with, etc. And then they were working on CES 33-7, which is the project report that they submitted to the government for redevelopment of Nal Bazaar. And a lot of the things that they could not talk about or that could not go into the project report, they invited me, we formed a collaborative, and we decided to make paintings that kind of talk about these kind of sub-tenancies within the city, right? So how is a space used? In the morning, a table becomes a cutting board. In the afternoon, you sleep on it. In the evening, you play cards on it. But these can't go into a project report that you submit to the government, right? Or 10 laborers that take up a room in near Goldeval Mandir, and then at the end of the month, those 10 laborers go back to that village, and 10 other laborers from the same village come in. And what is that cycle of sub-tenancy, rent control, when it's frozen? What does it do to the state of the building itself, the materiality of the building itself? How does all that play out? So much of these complex micropolitics was something that, I mean, if I could have captured it all in a photograph, I would stop at the photograph. But it had to be a step back, make a constructed image, be able to subvert the lens, open it out, break it open, look inside. So all of that became the Majlis Fellowship. And then our guide for that, I was telling Nancy, was Ghulam sir and Sudhir sir. So they became our guides for that project for the entire year, which was fun. Like, we went and we made work and then we showed it to them. And I worked with two architects. So it was literally us working on each other's paintings.
Right.
So an architect would do the drawing, I would do the painting. And then someone would say, Saurabh is doing a drawing, and he's like, oh, Ranjit may be able to paint the pipes nicely. So he's given that job. So it was very democratic. It was a strange kind of process as well. Three of us worked on a canvas, even if the concept for the drawing was mine. Unless all three of us agreed on what would go onto the drawing, I no longer had say in my own drawing. So I thought it was an interesting way to work, and the authorship question was something, that was something that Ghulam sir really liked about that work.
It sounds exactly like how the miniatures, so-called miniatures, were painted in the Mughal ateliers.
So that kind of led to us walking and going through all these sites, which I was taken to with the team that was doing that report. And while I was at that doing these walks, we started going into these trusts. So I asked Prasad Shetty, like, who's done work on trust, because we need some action. He's like, no one, you should. So I started looking much more seriously at the idea of like trusts within the city, charitable fund. So I thought it was philanthropy. I thought it was charitable institutions. But then that kind of, that definition gets kind of torn apart and broken, right? And so I had to go to the charity commissioner's office. Then suddenly I found that the charity commissioner's office has a listing of 12,000 trusts. So my project became 12,000 trusts. And then I managed to study 4,000 of them by looking at walking through for 2 years. So then I didn't draw for 2 years. So every time I wanted to do something, I was being pulled in another direction, which was what was needed at that point in time. So I would go in the morning, log my data, walk around, look for a trust, find the trust, try to get access to the trust, not get access, come back the next day to talk to the trust, the manager. The manager gives the appointment to talk to the trustee. So then you, so it becomes this entire process that you follow. And then you go back, log the data, find out whether the trust exists anymore, whether it's there for how long, etc. So it's also looking at an alternate form of philanthropy that's being practiced that counters the colonial narrative, which is one of, okay, we are saying it is post-colonial studies also talks about, it talks about the colonial authorities running the city. Mm-hmm. But the trust breaks that through the idea of agency. Right, you may say that someone is running it, but at the micro level, what are the interactions that are happening within it? You know, so I wanted to talk about this small time businessman that was doing work for his community or her community within that area. So I had to map it through categories of rehabilitation, animal welfare, migration, public health, social hygiene, education, which is a big one, and then there are these unique trusts. You know, there's a trust that looks after old and neglected trees. There's a trust that feeds a sweet flower to ants. There's a trust that there's a Khoja trust that gives curtains for the Dargah during the rain. You know, so disposal of the dead. So very basic, banal activities. Or there's a trust, Parsi trust, that basically is for whitewashing of the dhoka, for example. But it's all done scientifically. So I wanted, so diagramming the city in an alternate form became my form of practice, to kind of pull out unseen kind of stories of social history, in a sense. And of course, once you go into the archive, you go in wanting to do one project, and then you come out doing three other. So I'm sorry, I didn't talk about shipping at all.
That'll be next. The next question, I will remind you. Okay, but let me take these thoughts because you've already, both of
I
you
actually
were,
didn't. I didn't actually.
We'll come back to it. There's gobs of time. Have come back to shipping, shortly. Two or three things that come up from what both of you have already said. For one, it's the asymmetries that you find once you start looking at data. Because of course, of the three key themes of this evening, there's art, there's politics, but also the avalanche of information that we think has become available to us today in the digital age. But in some sense, in proportion to the magnitude of things, at any period, there's usually a vast amount of information through which, as an artist or a writer or a critic, you look for patterns. Yeah. So what interests me also in both your practices is a certain ability to track patterns in the information you're presented with, but also the kind of embodied research. You talked about seeking out these trusts, verifying them, logging them in certain ways. I want to take you back, as you dwelt very briefly on your training as a filmmaker, but I just want you to maybe revisit your time at the FTII, when you were training as a filmmaker and also made your first documentary. And it took you to a part of the country where you went with a certain mission and you had a certain objective. But when you got there, you realized that it was like nested boxes. And more things became clear to you. And then the artistic question was how to bear witness to all of that. So could I draw you out on that?
was many, many moons ago, another me. But yes, when I was at FTI, I think I was, so I must have been in my late 20s at that time. And I had done the editing course because, as you know, the institution has always been wrecked by all kinds of strikes and protests. Not just the ones that you hear about the last few years.
It's actually led one of the strikes, but I didn't say that.
No, I was part of one of the strikes.
You did that
one. when we were there. And the strike was because, of course, we did not have enough raw material to make the films, and then there were various other administrative problems and pedagogical ones as well. We wanted to create a new syllabus and so forth. But in the middle of all of that, I wasn't very satisfied with just doing editing because I had come there wanting to do a direction course, but because of various problems at that time institutionally, they had told us that the direction course would become a postgraduate course. So then each of us the ones who wanted to do direction had to pick up one or the other disciplines of either editing or cinematography or sound recording. And editing, of course, interested me, because I was always interested in the notion of, how do you recreate, the raw material that you've actually find on your editing table, and how do you read the patterns, how do you research, on the one hand, the director has actually made something for you and given it to you, right? But again, you have to again start researching and reading patterns, between those shots, recreating that whole narrative. And often, even at FTI, I was always given very low marks because whenever we were given, this was the Steenbeck days, not like now you have the digital software to edit. So you actually physically held that film and, you sat on the Steenbeck and you had the splicer,
yes, yes.
And stuff like that. So that the materiality of the film was very important. And I would just take these different pieces of, film which were given to us as school exercises, and I would always give a new interpretation to it. So, if I think that this is very patriarchal, sometimes what would happen is that in the bin, while giving us these exercises, they were very generic exercises, so they would give us some pieces of film which were, by mistake, they were printed double or treble. So I would use this mistake and then find a way of putting, making the narrative differently. So like two different approaches to the narrative. So the idea was that, so whether I'm writing or I was editing at that time in class at FTI, I would always find ways in which I could actually, explore whatever the existing paradigm was, because I would never be happy with that. So of course, the teacher would sort of, I think there was one exercise where I think Simon Dubois' Second Sex was there, So the narrative was very patriarchal, but this particular, there were these two lovers reading that book. So I found a way of actually bringing in a gendered perspective into that film. But of course, the teacher, didn't even realize what I'd done, and doesn't matter. But anyways, so the point is that, these were all my discontents, as it were. And I decided that even as I was finishing my editing course, because I was not allowed to do direction, I would make my own documentary. Of course, I don't know, in a way it was extremely foolish because I barely had any money, no help whatsoever. Already I'd earned my money to go to film school, and then now, I decided to make a documentary from where, and so there were these two students, one from cinematography and one from sound recording, they agreed to come with me and we went to Melghat, which is the forest belt of Maharashtra. And Melghat was at that time in the news in the late 1990s because of this problem of malnutrition amongst the Korku tribal community. And of course, I'd done my research in Pune because FTI is in Pune and there were lots of NGOs there working on this problem. And it, of course, the very reason why I decided to make the film was not just to talk about the statistics of malnutrition. It was because, again, already, I had done research in the interiors of Maharashtra, as I said earlier, because of my interest in the crafts. So I, again, wanted to go revisit the interiors, but from a different perspective. Now, not to look at craftspeople or performers, but to look at this tribal community, which would always be in the news as people who were, stigmatized. They would say people are illiterate there, they have very early weddings, the children die early because the parents can't take care of them. But I knew that there was this whole other side to this narrative which the state was peddling. to us. And of course, we realized that the Korku tribal community was completely pauperized there. And they would not give them any other jobs. And the employment schemes that were there were, you know, like making a road or building a bridge. And they were extremely undernourished and poor. And they would never have been able to do even that kind of work, which the state would give you, you know, I mean, under these employment schemes. So, and you know, they were completely isolated. So with all these problems, you know, I mean, I started thinking, you know, I mean, what if I visit this place? And of course, you didn't have the money to actually first go do a recce and then, you know, I mean, make the film and stuff like that. So there we were, you know, with this borrowed camera from an ex-FTI person. We went to Melghat. And of course, we worked under most difficult conditions. I was called a Naxalite by one of the police inspectors, and it was all, you know, I mean, yeah, I mean, one didn't know what kind of danger one was actually, in a way, you know, walking into, as it were, you know. So just three students, you know, with a lot of goodwill and, you know, I mean, ideas, and of course, not necessarily an understanding of what was happening under all the minefields that, you know, you had to actually navigate. And there, I mean, of course, again, I was, you know, I mean, I was encountering a polyphony of voices. And then you realize that within the margins also, there are more margins, you know. And so you know, I mean, on the one hand, of course, you can make fun of the school teacher who, you know, just doesn't come to class. And therefore, the children remain uneducated. But that's because also, I mean, education itself is something that's completely alienating, you know, because the school rooms are in a state of disrepair. The teachers are highly undermotivated. They don't have much, you know, I mean, in terms of, you know, money or you know, I mean, any kind of possibility of you know, upward mobility. So you meet the teacher, you meet the project, the people who are actually the bureaucrats. You meet the Anganwadi workers, you know, who are part of that community, and yet they sort of look down upon the women of their own community because now the government has given them the mandate to actually uplift these poor women. So I started looking at all these interstitial spaces and the micropolitics of how a community functions, and I think that in that sense, this. I would say this lesson that I took away from Melghat, you know, I mean, which I'm sure even if I had read 100 textbooks on it, I would never have actually got it. For example, today, you know, I mean, when I read about the Draft Forest Act, I'm sure all of you know that the Indian Forest Act of 1927, they have proposed an amendment of it today. And of course, there are lots of activists who have actually written against this amendment, this draft proposal. Because what they're doing is that before, of course, the tribal community would not be allowed to have access to the forest produce, the forest department would exploit them, put them into jail, etc. But now, the forest department has been given quasi-judiciary and paramilitary powers. They can actually shoot at sight. You know, they can put you into jail, and no questions asked. So the things that I'm reading now, I actually saw then, yeah. And I still remember in the film, it was very interesting. You know, I mean, I put up these three chairs, and you had this kind of in perspective, this forest kind of, you know, deep forest, you know, in the background. And then I told Shambhi Nanda, my camera person, I said, you know, they look like Gandhiji's three monkeys, you know. I mean, like, it was just one of those funny things. Anyways, we started the conversation, these three forest people from the forest department. We had various discussions, and then I said, but, you know, what are you doing for the people? So they said, oh, you know, we have bought these new cars and, you know, I mean, jeeps and stuff like that. And so I said, no, but what about the people? What are the provisions that you've made for the people here of Melga? And, you know, I mean, they just didn't have an answer. So there was this long pause, you know, where they couldn't even conceive of a situation where they would actually have to think about the human beings. You know, the human beings were always expendable. You know, they were just ciphers. And I think that for me, you know, I mean, of course, we were living under very difficult conditions. We had no place to stay often. We would stay in the house of a panchayat, a village panchayat person, because, you know, I mean, the project director there in Melghat was very angry with us because we had started looking critically at the situation there, and somebody had informed him. We were put up in a forest guest house. We need to go deeper into the interiors of Melghat. So one day we come back after a shoot. We are very tired, hungry. There's no food, nothing, and our bags have been thrown out. You know, so that the kinds of things that we actually went through. But of course, you know, I mean, at the end of the day, I mean, one, I mean, I made the film and it was shown. But the thing is that, again, you know, this was, I mean, about how to register this polyphony of voices. And again, how to translate into filmmaking, you know, I mean, the most possible complex picture of what you have experienced. Like, you know, you said, you know, going every day, logging in, logging out, all the experiences that you have, the micropolitics of the communities that you, you know, meet and encounter. So I think that the things that I actually, again, learned from this whole filmmaking process was working collaboratively, you know, which I think I'm too much of a soloist, but it was great. We didn't have a choice but to, you know, sort of work as a team. Of course, we had nobody we could trust. We didn't go there with an OB van or anything like that. We were just there, three students, no infrastructure, no support. No political, support of any kind, whereby, you know, in case, you know, we got into trouble, somebody could actually, you know, come to our rescue. So under those situations, I mean, again, when I think about it, I don't think I would have the courage today to just go like that, you know, I mean, into the forest and start making a film. But at that time, I think I had the courage. Maybe I was extremely foolish, but, you know, I mean, it's something I can't conceive of today, of doing today. But I think that, again, this was another, another signpost on my journey, so therefore today when I wrote my book on Navjot, for instance, or collaborative processes, again, you know, I'm not just writing something which is a dictation that the artist has given me, you know. It comes from all these multiple experiences of my own. So that's why I always say that when I write, you know, I mean, it's always an intersection between the artist's journey and my journey. So, you know, it is from that intersectionality that, you know, my work comes out, whether it's curation or writing, you know, because I also bring my own biography to bear on whatever I'm studying.
The note of biography. Box large. We're going to the ships now. But I just want to annotate briefly. Thank you very much for sharing that experience, which while it seems now it happened more than 20 years ago.
Yeah.
But as you were speaking, I just thought of how dramatically all of these things have changed. You refer to the Draft Forest Act. The way in which an act that was originally drawn up by a regime that was committed to extraction, to revenue extraction, is now redrafted by a supposedly post-colonial government.
Absolutely.
And it's much worse. It's actually
Mirgard is also Tiger Reserve.
Yes, exactly. The Project Tiger Reserve.
Project Tiger.
Yes.
So let me take those thoughts to you now, both in terms of how biography is transmuted into art for you, but also questions of how, let's say, large-scale scapes or institutions that you've known in one sense as a child, how do you then return to them as an artist who's drawing on these locations and these institutions as subjects, so to speak?
In shipping?
Now we're talking about shipping.
So, well, just a little background is my father is a shippie. He's at that period when shipping kind of switched from coal to bunker fuel, which is what ships run on today. And to give you context, Titanic was a coal ship, and he was a cadet in the 50s, which is in a company called Bharat Line, which was transporting logs from, used to do the run from Andaman to Calcutta. So that's when he was a cadet. And I remember as a kid, I remember him telling me that, yeah, these coal ships were very hot. So that was just one thing that had always stayed, you know. And then later on, I was completely not, because I was actually growing up, because he was not home so much, that I was like, I'm never going to go into shipping. You know, I've got nothing to do with it. I don't ever want to do that, etc., etc. And my interest in shipping actually came through the idea of waste and documenting waste and looking at Chor Bazaar and looking at the idea of what happens to goods as they degrade. You know, I was very interested in the idea of the worth of an object from the point that it is new to the point that it becomes an artifact. And then there's always this in-between period where it has no worth, right? So there's a certain, if that same object 1,000 years later becomes very priceless, but at the point when it is an everyday object, so what is its role, nature, etc., where does it circulate? So that's where the idea of looking at it, where it is still not important enough, or it has lost its worth. And I wanted to look at the stories and document it through the idea of utility, non-utility, through the idea of the assemblage, through the idea of the broken object. And then in Chor Bazaar, there were these very interesting people that are doing very interesting things with objects, second-hand objects. And on a larger scale, objects and broken-down ships. So those are the two registers that I was working at. And so Chor Bazaar became the project where I decided to build a game. And I worked with programmers, and one of the programmers is here, Carrie. So we kind of worked on building a game to look at like the decontextualized object and offer it as a space that is decontextualized from the site itself and goes into this online realm. And then I wanted to give it an idea of play. So we wanted to look at the tinkerer. The tinkerer is the person, and walking around so much, finally one day I got accosted by two or three of these
tinkerers.
Like, there's this guy named Peter, there's this man named Sultan, and then we went into a coffee shop, and that's where they were selling watches. So he's talking to me while there are someone coming in front, sitting in front of him. He would take out a watch from here, show it to him, and then he'd put it back into his other pocket. Or there would be people that would come with watches and ask to sell it. So he was doing the same thing while he was having a conversation with me, you know. And so it was these kind of very interesting people that were. This person named Sultan also said that I put up the first display window in Chor Bazaar. Hmm. So he was like, it was never done before. Everybody saying, "Aap Sultan bhai, aap kya pagal ho gaye ho?" Because either everything works in this thieves market, underhand, this, that, what are you doing? You know? He's like, "No, it will work, this, that." So it was this very strange kind of idea. Then there was this, Peter was this guy that took lamps and he would put Freon in it and he would light it up. So he was taking one object that was disused and he was making it attractive and he was doing something else to it. So he was changing the value. So we wanted to work with the idea of value. So I collaborated with a media scholar, Amit Rai, from Queen Mary, and another scholar, Sadhvi Dar, who works on CSR, corporate social responsibilities and ethics. So I did a residency in London where they said, "Why don't you come and walk the markets of London?" So to do this kind of value exchange good, because there's so many markets in London. There are people that are foraging the Thames, you know, that's the national pastime, is that you're going to hit it big. So you afford value to an object and then you put it into a space in a market and then you construct stories around it. And then I always like to pay more money for the story, you know, that is attached to the object, whether I know that that person is like really taking on a royal ride. But I like the idea of, you know, that the buccaneer or whatever, like, the more crazy the story, the more...
You know what Kurosawa said? It doesn't matter whether the story is true or false. It has to be a good story.
Exactly. Yes. So it became this kind of... And then there was this other very interesting history of like how there's this kind of industry that pops up, you know. There is parallel to the second-hand industry, there is the film industry with the Chor Bazaar. There's the photographic, you know, studio industry. Then there is also, now there is, till recently, there is the second-hand cars that are broken down, etc. So now what starts to happen is these industries start layering into businesses. So for example, there are compressors that were bought and sold in Chor Bazaar to a point where the compressor was could be bought and sold for rented. So there were five machines and it would be rented out to nearby construction sites where painters come from Goldeol, because there's a labor market there, which we also documented in the Gentricity project. So that's how I came to this. But then what started happening there was that very interesting thing that the compressors were being rented out, and the rent would be 100 rupees for 1,000 rupees, 500 rupees for the deposit, 100 rupees per day. But then you could buy it for 2,000 or 3,000. So a business popped up of like buying and selling of this. So, you know, and you walk down Chor Bazaar, and then I heard someone say, duplicate ka koi asli pehchan nahi hota. Like, you know, asli duplicate ka koi pehchan nahi hota. Strange kind of thing. And you turn around, and I don't know, me and Amit were there, we turn around and we don't know who had said that. It was just someone telling someone else and just trying to sell him something. Because he was haggling about price. It's just this kind of crazy moment that kind of brings that kind of validates why you want to do that project, yeah. You know?
Asli duplicate.
Ka koi pehchan nahi. I was like, okay. So this works on one level of looking at waste, and then the larger scale of waste was through the shipping project, where I was always interested in ship is a collection of objects that come together, that work with value through labor, where there is labor extraction through modes of practice, through the idea of Moby Dick and how C.L.R. James talks about, yeah. You know, through Renegades became one of the main papers that Stefano and I worked on. Stefano Ani, he told me to read that, and that became this kind of idea of looking at C.L.R. James writing about Moby Dick and the ship as being the factory, right? And so this notion of the factory at sea was something that the personal history of my father was there as the factory of the sea, and I imagine dad is being within, you know. And then my particular interest was always in, I was very interested in how ships were broken. And my first question was, how many nuts and bolts in a ship? So I wanted that question answered. You know, like how do you answer that question? 5,000, 10,000, but we are talking time with riveted ships. I couldn't answer that question. So that is the first question I want to ask. Then how do I talk about it through a practice? You know, how do I talk about it when it's broken down? So there's that reimagination of a space. Then that gets attached to the reimagination of site, which is alum, which is where I have been doing research for, I think now, seriously since 2010, but I was going to CED and looking at...
CED seems to be a formative university yes. For all of
yeah,
us.
Yeah, well, it kind of, yeah.
You should probably explain...
Center for Education?
Center of Education and Documentation.
It's behind Regal Cinema. And it was basically newspaper clippings of, and then I started some basic kind of collation of reading that, and then I didn't do anything with that information. I was just, while I was doing everything else, I was just kind of documenting and looking at that. In the meanwhile, I started kind of saying that maybe I need to go to site. So a very interesting thing started happening is I had to go through contacts and I had to go secretly to Alam in order to gain, like, because it's a contentious site, you know, you can't just walk on, etc. You can go in, but you can't take photographs, etc., etc. And then it started playing parallelly with this kind of history of my father's travels, because my father becomes a captain in the 70s, and he works mainly for Indian companies, and which kind of go everywhere, so he's gone all over the world. But what the interesting thing is, my mother traveled with him everywhere. So he also had this habit of taking photos from the bridge of the ship, of the front part, you know. So I had this entire archive of photos of all from the time that he's a, even from the time that he's a cadet. And all these photos of all the different ships. So that Andaman, Calcutta run, there's a photo of these, you know, logs that are tethered on the bulk, you know, on the entire bulwark right along in the front. Then there are ships. So there's a whole series of photos before he got married. Then there's a series of ships. So he has all these strange kind, and because he was also, to kind of put it into perspective, mad photographer. Like, he was never without a camera, you know. So I grew up with seeing him with, like, you know, cigarette, lungi, and, you know, Electro 30, Ashika Electro 35. That was his uniform, you know. So it was this kind of, he was constantly family photographs, shipping. So I had this kind of archive of his travels, which became this space for me to, not, I didn't want to, I actively didn't engage with it actually till Bergen Assembly. With those photographs, because I, by accident, or we were just talking, and to the curator of the show, Stefano, I showed him these photographs, and what I had done was I had treated the photographs. I had taken photos that my father had taken of my mother just after they got married, and I layered them over these ships, the photographs that he had taken before. You know, and so it was this kind of idea of why he's taking these photos, etc., etc. But I didn't want to explain the photographs. So Ranjit was there for that show. So a lot of the explanation for the photographs was not a personal memory archive, but was the logistical infrastructure of that particular ship. So Jayanti Shipping, active from, you know, Birla. It was a Birla-run company, active from like 72 to so and so. The where all it did, it had bulk carriers, etc. Bharat Line, which is the log carrier. Then there is the Great Lakes. My father kept going through the Great Lakes. So there are all these photos that that I have that he has taken, where he is with my mom on those travels, you know, and then. But the Great Lakes becomes this very interesting look at shipping infrastructure, because it happens at a very important point in shipping, where I use these works to kind of talk about a very important point in shipping, which is the 50s onwards, shipping explodes in this very different way. The scale of shipping becomes something that needs to be calculated in what you call TEU, you know, which is 20-foot extension units. So now, one unit is 20 feet, and you have ships that are 18,000 TEU. So that's the length of the ship. So 18,000 into 20 is the length of that ship. And container ships are now the way the industry works. So these 50 years, from like 1950 to about 2000, is the time when my dad is in shipping, and there is, through his archive, there is this shipping infrastructure that's changing. Like, for example, the Great Lakes, they decide not to expand their canal system the way the Panama Canal and the way Suez Canal expanded. So it's very interesting that they lose business, because they think that we'll be okay with corn and ore, and we don't need the rest of the world. But then the minute the ships, the scale exploded, there is a Panamax, which is Panama Max, and that's the maximum size of the ships that can go through the Panamax canals. Then you have post-Panamax, so they can't fit through. So they have to then go around. And then the Panama Canal extends. Now a different thing happens. The price of fuel will determine whether the ship will, if the price of fuel is too high, then they'll go through. Otherwise, the price of fuel is this, then they'll say, no, take 20 days extra, go around the Cape. So there's this, so shipping is in this very strange space, and it's extremely invisible. Shipping infrastructure is one of the most invisible infrastructures in our time. And one of the most visible parts of shipping infrastructure, unfortunately, becomes the ship breaking yard, which by the shipping industry is like decontextualized and treated as waste. So what I'm saying is, we can't just look at the shipping infrastructure. We have to look at the shipping industry that creates the informality within which ship breaking operates. So a lot of the work, and I didn't want to do it visually. That is one of the main things. So sound was something that I decided to take up. And I basically spent time at the yards recording each and every part of the ship being broken, which is from the front of the yard right up till the ship, entered the ship, and I went with a sound recordist, and we started kind of just documenting as raw data, a sonic scale, a soundscape that would, I want to just say one more thing about, I want to just say one more thing about, for example, I was very interested because over the last 10-15 years, it has become a certain visual practice of looking at a space like Ya'ala, you know, a metaphor or a space that kind of gets talked about the injustices that are happening, and it's a very particular eye that allows the attention to only remain, you know, in the waste rather than in the West.
Yes.
You know, so the West to West is the kind of the divide which is still extremely colonial in its kind of mode of operation. And this is something that I wanted to try to, like, through a longer process, kind of say that let's try to look at this through labor, because the labor is also looked at in a way that there is a piece that is done every year where the focus goes on the laborer's leg that sinks into mud, and it's a fetishized object as photography. And this as practice is, it's a seductive image. We are seduced by the grandeur and the image itself. So it dissipates immediately when you see it, and it's not attractive, but at the same time you can't avoid it. And this is what I was kind of wanting to engage with. And one example that I just wanted to talk about was the cutting of the propeller. I just found that when I went there and when we were recording sound, one of the things, propeller technology is one of the most advanced technologies of ship. I mean, it's put through this kind of the Wonderwall forces. There's this wind tunnels. So there are Wonderwall forces acting on it, and they run it through a funnel of water to kind of, and it uses kind of bronze. It's an alloy, right? So this alloy, making this alloy and fabricating propellers is extremely technologically advanced. It's one of the most advanced technologies. So what I was really interested in was the way it was cut. So it is cut because the central shaft of the propeller has four blades, and these blades are high grade. So they cost a lot. So you remove a propeller and you put it, it's as big as this room, and it will cost 5 crores. But there's no one can come and pick up the propeller and steal it. So they're not worried about anyone stealing the propeller in the middle of the night from the yard. But the yard owner already has someone to come and kind of take it away. But how does he do it? He will get laborers to come. All the laborers come from Jamnagar. So they're highly skilled. So the supervisor on site told me, like, saab, aap ya hum kaatenge to 15 din lagega. You know, it'll take like 15 days. But these guys will do it in 3 days flat. But how do they do it? They have to cut against the grain, and they'll cut it using a thin blade and a three-sided wooden handle. And they'll cut it with an exact skill. So I recorded the sound of that. And that's the most beautiful sound I've ever heard. But it's also trapped data. So for me, that was entropic data that is kind of trapped in the sound, which harks back to a mode of looking at a ship breaking practice. And this practice kind of is singular in a very kind of particular labor intensive to kind of look at it through not valorizing. But that's a problem too. I mean, for me, that was a problem. How to not talk about how a particular a laborer or the site supervisor talks about being on site through power relations, you know?
Yes.
Because the manager is someone that is put there by the owner of the yard. And so I went to the manager and said, when is the next huge section being dropped? Because I need to record that sound. And he very sheepishly said, Saab, I don't know. You'll have to ask the site supervisor, who I thought was lower in the, you know.
But had more knowledge.
Had more knowledge, is the one who does the breaking, period. So when I go and I talk to him, the hierarchy that is supposed to reduce as you go onto the beach actually increases. And he was just a very nice guy. He told me, "Arey, hum udhar jata hi nahi hai. Usko ma, he wants to know something. He comes to me." So he can only give me the hard hat and the gloves and whatever, but he is not in the know. I will tell you when it breaks. I will tell you when it is safe to go, etc. And I can walk off the site right now, the entire... So this power relation is something that is stunning in the way that it's organized.
Yep.
And that is what I wanted to kind of look at through this work, among other things, yeah.
That is... it's an amazing narrative on many, many levels. But as you were speaking, I thought this... I know this will resonate very strongly with you, Nancy, because it raised images of one of your favorite artists, who you showed when you did the Gwangju Biennale, Alan Sekular, and also notions of how shipping can be a forgotten space, as he puts it. But also...
Poti.
Indeed. But also, all these notions of the granularity of the political, how power is actually distributed, where it articulates itself, how this works out at the level of the city, the neighborhood, the informal settlement. For you, many of these discoveries that you made during your own practice, I have a sense that this is how it happened, was in the early 2000s, when you were actively associated with Sarai, when you were an associate fellow at the Center for the Study of Developing Societies. Also the time when you were editor of Art India. So do you want to talk a little bit about that period, when being part of Sarai, being open to what one of the colleagues at Sarai refers to as pirate modernities, being part of that whole discussion, how did that translate, or how did that play out in your work as editor of Art India, when you were looking at what were then newly emerging practices, which were more overtly dedicated to new media, to the digital space, and to political agencies?
Yes, this is you know, it's a constant.
I'm dragging both of them back into that.
It's a constant movement towards the past. But I think Sarai was, just as we were talking about CED, was like a kind of, I mean, it was a library, but it was also a convivial space for various scholars and researchers to meet. So in the same way, Sarai in Delhi was such a space. But in fact, I would say Sarai went one step further than even CED, because at CED, we would all be doing research, and then sometimes we would confer with each other. But at Sarai, it was actually driven by the Rux Media Collective, Shuddha, Monica, and Jibesh, as well as their colleagues from film, the two, Ravi Vasudevan and Ravi Sundaram. And I think I was very, very fortunate at that time in my career to be invited to speak at Sarai, to be given a fellowship, there to look at, for instance, I had a fellowship. One of the first fellowships was actually to look at new media practices, not the overground ones, as it were, the ones that were done by the visual artists, like let's say Vivan Sundaram or Nalini Malani, but to look at the underground of new media. And this is also something very interesting, because actually Transmediale, which you would know, you may even have spoken there, at the Transmediale, Andreas Brockman had invited me to give a lecture on new media practices. This was in the when new media was in its formative stage on the visual arts scene. And I decided that I would of course talk about Vivan, Nalini, Ranbir Kaleka and others, but I remember I was just taking the train back home at that time from the Churchgate station, and I took the underpass, and I was looking at all these various photoshops, you know, in the underpass. And this was a time in the early 2000s when they were using this Photoshop software to convert the family photograph into an object of fantasy. So you could take your family photograph. It doesn't matter whether you live in the slums or you're living in a chawl or even a middle class housing. You take it to this Photoshop, and then they will, completely transform your photograph to meet your desires. So supposing if you want to show your image against the Taj Mahal, then they make that possible, or it could be the Grand Canyon, whatever was your heart's desire. So I just thought that I couldn't really just give a lecture on new media art as done by visual artists. That was, in a sense, the official narrative of new media art. I knew that I had also to look at this whole economy of visuality. And that's how it started. So I gave the lecture, and then, when Sarai was giving out these fellowships, which was on the interstices of visual culture and technology, I sent this proposal, and it was accepted. And then I not only studied the underpasses, of Churchgate Station, but I also went to Ramoji Film City to look at, the kinds of sites that they would, manufacture, for filmmakers, So you could actually go and shoot in those sites, which were completely, they were completely manufactured, the entire scenography, the props, and so forth. So I think Sarai, for me, was definitely one of these convivial spaces. And we didn't really have much of a discussion on these formative net cultures, for instance, in Bombay. So I think being there at Sarai was definitely very helpful. And I think Rux Media Collective and the two Ravis, they conceived of very, very pertinent symposium on notions of the commons, for instance, on technology in everyday life. And I think, I was privileged to be part of those conversations. And then again, when I was the editor of Art India, as I would always say, because my papa is a doctor, I not only wish, as a theorist, I'm not only interested in being a diagnostician, which is to read the signs of the times, read the symptoms, and then create a framework or theory around it. But I also would like to be a prognostician, which is to, talk about something which is not yet born, but where you can see the signs and therefore you can sort of sketch out a picture. And that's how I did the first issue of Net Cult, called Net Culture, in the early 2000s. And I remember inviting Beju to give me one of the images from his early works based on a net installation for the cover, for the cover of the magazine. So I think again, you know, as I was saying, you know, I've often taken many detours in my journey, you know, but on each of these detours I have met very interesting mentors, colleagues, and I think that all of them have contributed to the life of my mind in different ways.
I'm going to ask you the same kind of question now, Ranjit, because there's what runs through your work is not only recording, registering, and analyzing as a diagnostician, but also like a prognostician. You actively create fictive scenarios, counterfactuals, yeah. Invented objects, especially in relation to the city and its tropes of reclamation, fortification, and so on. So, in dealing with that, I'm going to ask you, Dani, you've alluded already to your larger community, but just like for Nancy, this was the larger community in which not only new forms of art making, but also new forms of attentiveness to the political were developed. Where would you say what is your community of practice?
I always like to talk about it through like the idea of like a lens, or an opening up of a lens in that sense. For example, like there are signs within how you view a city, you know, in terms of the actual physicality of the city itself. And then there are kind of reverberations, there are like underpinnings, there is something that holds the city together, there is a history of that, what brought it to that space and at that kind of understanding of it. And then there is an entire other city which is written out in the archive as things that happened, you know, that things that took place. But the idea of speculation is something that I've always been interested in, because while doing some of these projects, while doing the trust project, I kept coming across this really crazy kind of documentation of how reclamation was done in the city. So reclamation became this aside that I just started looking at and just kind of collecting this information, you know. And it goes into these ideas of like, how do you document? Do you document like the speculative fiction, you know? How do you document it as the idea of the hoax? What is the idea of the hoax that plays in the idea of truth telling? So a lot of my trust project was, I need to get to the bottom of this. But where does my practice come in this? Because it is a documentation of me trying to find out what has happened. Then does it only become a record? Or is it a document? Or where is my practice within this document? Now, fortunately or unfortunately, a lot of the trusts are missing. So the missing archive is my document that becomes a record that may become my practice or not. Or is my practice just the act of recording through the lens of the trust, for example? Like to say that there is a mode of philanthropy being practiced by trusts through the informality of communities that are fulfilling a need that the government is not taking care of, and documenting this through drawing. Is that my practice? I mean, there were these kind of various registers that become a kind of, like I said, like the idea of an unseen social history.
Yes.
And so a lot of community-based philanthropic practice is also extremely insular. It's, you have a musafirkhana that is there generally for people within the own community, but it's also open.
Right.
But who accesses it? How is it? What are the politics of it? Where is the area, etc., etc.? But is there an imagination of the city that is operating as a whole, as through all these communities? Are they performing the same practice?
Right.
And are these practices like coming into certain modes of daily life? You know, so the new part of what I want to do is something called maintenance of daily life. like looking at that idea of the everyday act as being another form of philanthropy, for example. Whether it is actually what happened, I don't know, you know. But the idea that we perform this as an everyday lived practice, is that the practice of the city collectively? It's deeply entrenched within the colonial kind of
armature.
Yes, but was that is that the kind of imagination within the kind of, so these are some of the kind of like the idea that a lot of it does not even show itself. You know, it's reclamation is easily relevant today when you talk about the coastal roads, when you talk about the crazy plan. I mean, if I will just give you two examples or three examples of, you go into any record, you go into any archive, and what they wanted to do was, where the bay is, the eastern waterfront, which is from here till Navasheva, the idea was to reclaim the whole thing. So they still have this idea of reclamation.
Yeah.
Like reclamation was done to the Hornby Wellard, which is from your Haji Ali Juice Center till Worli Village, right? That entire Wellard which is built was done to block the tide from flooding. And the water would flood all the way till Pai Dhoni. So by the time it reached your feet, Pai Dhoni, correct? So this idea of reclamation was done to solve a very localized idea of flooding. But the minute there is land that is replaced this, suddenly there's, oh, now there is something else that can be done here. So now let's monetize this. And then you have something called this secret and politics department, which is set up, which is there in the public department diary, before the what became the PWD, which is there in Elphinstone College, Public Works Department. It was actually the public department diaries. That has, but you know how haphazard it is, because at one level the British is saying, oh, we need these many guns to counter Tipu Sultan, and next topic is Bombay. So it's not structured through, it's structured through Tipu Sultan and Bombay. Those are your subcategories. It's not even the same category that you're operating in. So that's the colonial kind of organization that is happening. But at the same time, it's this crazy alternate archive of the mistake is drawn into that. And that mistake is there to date. I mean, to say that this, for me to do a topic on looking at loss of flora and fauna. For example, I did a project in 2015 with, which is Geographies of Consumption, with Mohile Parikh Center. And that was basically, I wanted to talk about extinction. Due to reclamation, what were the plants and flora and fauna that were lost due to reclamation? So I go to BNHS and I say the word extinction, and they literally almost drive me. I'm like, no, you cannot say the word extinction. It's lost habitat. So conditions that are no longer favorable leads to a loss of habitat. And a type locality is, around its locality, the type that is found. It's a geological term, which is used by zoology, botany, etc. So my project from extinction became type locality of lost habitat of type localities.
Oh my God.
Right? So now it wasn't that it's extinct, but you just cannot find it there anymore. But in the archive, you will find hammerhead sharks that were found till off the shore. They used to be caught in fishermen's nets till the mid-90s. Then sea dugongs, sea elephants, used to wash up at Kulaba Church. You know, the shy civet cat is something that graduated, that kind of migrated into Pakistan. But it's called the Indian civet cat. But what do you call it? What do you call it now? Is the Indian civet cat in Pakistan? It's a strange. They don't understand borders, right? But the border is there.
Like the giant polybars.
There you go. So even the most extreme case of the Indian cheetah, you won't get anyone in BNHS that will say, no, it's extinct.
It's gone.
There is somewhere that there may be a chita that we don't know of, but it's a lost habitat. The last two in captivity, etc. So this very interesting form of loss of habitat is again happening with, say, the Shivaji statue. There is an article that has come out about what is going to be the loss of habitat of marine life, that kind of, you know, that is that's going to lose its habitat at that on the western shelf. Now this is really, for me, this kind of mode of like just bringing up this lens to say that we keep repeating the same mistakes and it's plain as day. And but it's not that you don't have to look far, you just have to look in the archive. And all our mistakes are there. On that positive note.
That positive note indeed. Yeah, gosh. Now I'm gonna open it up to questions.
High time.
No.
High tide.
Enjoying these accounts. Also because there is sometimes a tendency to see political art as a kind of art making that has a ready-made object called the political, which is not true. So part of what I wanted to really achieve today is to look at the paradox, the granularity, the detours by which artists, curators, theorists, filmmakers actually approach the question of the political, how in fact they construe it. And really, I'm really grateful to both of you for having talked about your practices in this way. Also because sometimes, not always, sometimes people tend to see politics and art as somehow largely a kind of sloganeering activity, something that has to do with headlines and the obvious part of the political. Whilst all of this, everything that you've talked about today, really addresses the understructures that go into the political. So I'm really going to open it up to questions now.
Okay, so just looking at that, the online space, how has that whole online impacted both your practices? Because it's such a granular, such a tight practice, both of you, when you are talking, so you can always visualize all that you are saying. How are you going to, how are you impacted? Firstly, does that online digital mode impact your practice? Have you engaged with it? And how do you see yourselves in the future engaging with it? Just take off from what that says as well.
So my practice is actually extremely online. I'm an incessant website maker. I don't make websites, but I get my friends to do it for me. But I have like about 8 or 10 websites with each project that becomes a kind of a repository. So City Influx actually, which is one of the first projects that I kind of conceptualized, became this space where I was talking earlier about the documenting of the walls. So it's, if you log on, there is a work called Hygiene, which is the walls that I've done a series of paintings, and I keep adding paintings that I do of different walls or the same wall, and I keep adding it, but you can access only part of the drawing. So it's also a lens of how the parallel city is unfolding. I mean, it's a very derivative way of like talking about going into the online, but the mode of engaging with it as an online space is to direct it through the idea of the technology that you access through media, through new media, and also how, in a sense, mirroring how a lens works of what we, like the wall becomes, for me, the wall is the marker of the city. Like, it is constantly being layered and layered over, and people are accessing it. It's become an invisible space, it's an ignored space. So I make work of documenting trains. So trains form like the majority of like my practice, because I use trains all the time. So one of the things that I made this work called Borivali versus Virar, which is kids that would travel on the train by sitting on top between the bogies, and it becomes this invisible space that that is not looked at by the authorities. Now it's illegal to do it, absolutely. But right up till I think 2010 or 12, you would have people, even if there was space in the train, they would sit outside because there's breeze, right? It's extremely dangerous. They are pitting their lives in this kind of mode of pleasure, of travel, in a sense, without trying to fetishize it. But it was interesting why I wanted to make that work is because I was standing on Borivali foot over bridge, and this kid was sitting there on the train as it came in from Virar, and he looked at me and he like gave me the finger, you know, and he told me basically that this is my space. I see you, I see your privilege, I know you never had the guts to this, and he was smiling at me. And I smiled at him and I took a photo. And he's like, ah, Bezna. So it was this kind of strange moment where it was this invisible space that became a painting, that became a space that was, which I, for this work, was through painting, through drawing. But it kind of takes on that idea of an online space. So the Chor Bazaar project was precisely that. So Chor Bazaar, also parallelly with Amit, we've been walking Chor Bazaar for about 10-12 years. I grew up in Kulaba, but I remember in 9th standard, everybody wanted BMs, Doc Martens, right? Those were the ones we found. For 800 rupees, I got Doc Martens from Chor Bazaar. And I didn't care whether it was... I mean, I could be more this thing if it was more of a... This thing, second hand. So that is the history of the access, but I made that project literally 20-25 years later, where I wanted to decontextualize that site. So I built an online game, and now it's really interesting because now what I'm doing is I'm going to be in touch with the with all the shop owners at Chor Bazaar. I want them to tell them to sell all their wares on my website. So that site has to work for them as well. It's not my vanity project at the same time, you know. So online is important. The Seven Islands project with Karen and the whole group of programmers is we made fake maps because the archive, the British East India Company records say that, you know, oh, you want to reclaim? Run a channel from... from east to west, and divide Bombay into north and south. So we made a fake map. So I took the map of I took the outline of Thames, and I put it on Bombay, and then I made a fake map which talks about this, and we can navigate it. So it kind of these speculative maps that kind of talk about a very interesting point in the city's timeline, where it's really strange, you know, that the reclamation could have gone. Anyway, it could have been like if you look at, we always talk about Seven Island reclamation, but area wise, the largest reclamation that has happened in Bombay is Trombay, like area wise, size wise. But Seven Islands is actually very small scale reclamation. There's a much larger kind of this. Yeah, so online is a difficult space. It's not always negotiable. It's not always like it doesn't work, but you have to make it. I try to make it work as part practice, part repository, in a sense.
So I mean, I know that people are clamoring now to
be let out
as it were. So very briefly, just to say, in my own theoretical practice, I have of course engaged with the works of artists like Shilpa Gupta, Beju Parthan, the Cyber Mohalla Collective. Artists who worked and engaged with the digital sphere. But also apart from writing on such artistic practices, as a scholar, as a researcher, definitely the net has revolutionized forms of scholarly conviviality, you know, because of these adjacencies that the net sphere produces, scholars can actually communicate in real time, which perhaps earlier might not have been the case. So apart from this politics of adjacencies, which, you know, gets a completely different contouring, I would say that even today, I mean, of course, there is much that is there on the net. I mean, it's like a katha sarit sagar, you know, it's an ocean of stories. But as a practitioner, I would always say that, I mean, I always work, you know, in the meso realm between the online and the offline spaces. And for me, that's always very, very important. I mean, I do not fetishize or valorize the online space. So I think, that's as briefly as I can put it.
And curated online?
No, but I mean, I in my very early, show, in fact, the very first show that I co-curated, Zoom, Art in Contemporary India, I had included one of Beju's works, which was a digital.
Is that curating online? Is this something that might be appealing to you?
Yes, yeah. Definitely, yeah, definitely.
So, use of art, as a mode for activism, in the digital space. So, as a curator or as a critic, how do you evaluate, the impact of, these kind of initiatives online? So, is it really the engagement, or is it the impact that it brings? For example, the political means that are made nowadays. So do you consider that art, how do you evaluate such, these forms of art which are used as, modes for activism?
It is a very interesting question, because in fact I feel that, apart from this, early flicker that we had in the early 2000s, I think, because, in a way the market devours everything, within the Indian art context. So we haven't really had that many interesting, net-based installations, I would say after the early 2000s. And perhaps one of the reasons also for this is that what you actually see today within the digital public sphere, as it were, which is, what you were saying, that there are people who are contributing to the sphere through GIFs, through, quick debates on social media, for instance, Twitter, Facebook, and so forth. And I think that the fact that they are able to do this, as I said, quickly in real time, and to actually speak to that topical moment, is something that our visual artists haven't been able to really do, or at least I don't think that they've been able to find language. While many of these other contributors, who may be working in an animation studio during the day, but in the night they would be doing uncommissioned work, and they'll immediately make a GIF and put it up, and actually it becomes a very important sparking point for a discussion. And I think that sometimes when I look at some of these animations or GIFs that people have made, which actually question the retrogressive policies of Hindutva politics, some of them are actually extremely good. And they are engaging with the language of the digital sphere as well. They are trying to in fact invent a new language. So often, you will not necessarily find, things of value within the mainstream visual arts scene. You might find it from contributors, who could be an engineer, animationist,
Could I add to that?
Yeah, please.
I mean, I think the problem to that also lies within the technology itself. Like the idea that it is quick, like everything that the way you consume it, is how do you hold someone's attention for more than the Instagram like or the Twitter feed or the link or the TikTok or everything that kind of comes with this time limit. So the critique of it, which is being offered or which is even trying to be extended within this, is also dismissed and not given the seriousness because of the
ephemerality of the
system within which it is created. Like, it works both ways. Like, it may be good content, but how is that content
how do you sustain it?
Exactly.
Yeah.
it also points to the fact that a lot of these are individual efforts, mm-hmm. or they're in a space that is vaguely called the called civil society, a term that has now lost meaning because yeah. everybody is sort of making a claim on it. But the tragedy is that very, very few of those, practically none of them, are linked to a more material,
yeah.
actual politics in the arena of politics. Mm-hmm. And that is actually a great, it's mm-hmm. really, we're at a moment of great failure for the Republic because of that. There really isn't a practical politics of resistance. So whilst yeah. many cultural actors, cultural agents might well articulate themselves in this way, they are not a cogent enough force, and we saw that a couple of months ago. So
yeah, because also the technology has done this really strange thing, right? Like the photograph, Eugene Ajit walking through the streets of Paris,
yeah.
etc. I mean, these were supposed to be the documentary image that could do no wrong.
Yes, exactly.
That could not be, that it was never, although the photograph itself was not a settled image because of the technology. It was always, yeah,
it was
an in-between, it was
yeah.
not settling.
Yeah.
But when it settled, when the technology improved, the technology also could be morphed. The technology moved beyond, it's staying in where it was supposed to be the proof, to be, you know, evidence. It moved beyond that,
yeah.
and that messed everything up, obviously, because it would. Because now you can do, like now there are surveillance technology where you can, I read something really interesting yesterday, was that, you know, the mime artists in France, they have this clown face. Like they make these strange patterns on their face, and that is one of the first things that is fooling face recognition.
Mm-hmm.
So it cannot, if you make a black mark here, it's not recognizing a jawline, so it cannot recognize the face because this is white all the way through, so the jawline is not being recognized. So it's being, but that can be used, but it can also be misused. So that's the nature of the times
that
we live in.
We don't seem to end on particularly joyous notes.
That's just
Again, that'll be the last question.
In terms of a cultural theorist and an artist, okay, y'all are normally doing exhibitions and displaying your work, like you're making a documentary movie. And what when you are giving out a message, okay, you are giving out a narrative, okay. How do you manage your ethics in terms of making sure that your opinion is not being influenced because you have a bias? Like say I see as something like a white wall, you know, I want to tell people this is off-white, and
yeah.
I will direct the narrative in the manner. So because what your opinions are not WhatsApp forwards, they are actually valued opinions. So how do you manage your ethics in that? Like, I just was very curious.
Bye. Continuously engaging. That's how, I mean, even the hygiene work for me was a problematic work that I learned from. Like, because I remember that I was talking about it a certain way. Like, the engagement of documenting something that happens as experience comes with acknowledging your own, first of all, also acknowledging your own privilege. And if you acknowledge your privilege, and then there is not to say that you don't have the right to the opinion that you speak of, right? It's worse if you take and don't acknowledge where or talk down to. But if you talk about it in a certain way, it can also be misconstrued as being
as being
something that is, like, for example, I did this project, small project, on Knut Hamsun, who is a Norwegian writer who wrote this very famous novel called Hunger, for which he won the Nobel Award for Literature, right? And he really went after the left-leaning authors, saying that you only talk down to the people that you are writing about,
yeah.
because you're the one that, it's also, they say, that's where the failure of the left comes from, etc., etc., that you talk down to them, you talk down to the protagonist as being someone that has more information,
okay,
which was acknowledged by them at that time.
Okay.
But Knut Hamsun was at a different level. He was a Hitler.
He was a right winger.
He was a complete right winger. He kind of was maligned by the Norwegian government. They stripped him of his this thing. People who love children that grew up reading Knut Hamsun, Hunger, etc., went into his village and threw their copies of their books in his backyard, stuff like that. So Gitanjali actually did this small project, and we worked on this kind of project that deals with this problematic. So engaging at the same time, talking about, I mean, it's one thing to talk about and acknowledging, even acknowledging,
yeah,
what the work that you're doing within the levels that you're doing it,
yeah,
is important as an inherent practice.
Well, very briefly, I mean, just to say, the way I approach my theoretical practice, I think for me it's very important to state my positionality, you know, vis-a-vis the subject that I'm studying. And I think that, you know, I do not have a problem in saying that, yes, you know, I mean, I will be studying this subject from a Marxist feminist perspective. And I mean, there would be theoreticians or critics, you know, who perhaps would not necessarily reveal where they're coming from. So in that sense, you can say there is a bias, right? But at the same time, the way I conduct my practice, you know, I mean, the kind of self-criticality that I impose upon myself means that I am ready, you know, to have, you know, whatever ideas that, you know, I bring to the table, you know, I mean, I don't have any problems if those ideas are dismantled or if they get subverted in the process of research, you know. And I think that it's important not to start with predetermined ideas. It's always good to be surprised. It's always good for your research to make an unpredictable detour.
Absolutely.
And I think for me that's very, very important. But as far as bias goes, you know, I mean, because, you know, I think there's this kind of cliched thing even in journalism. You know, I remember when we, you know, we were studying journalism, that, you know, I mean, this whole binary between subjective and objective.
Mm-hmm.
You know, of course you will have your own biases, but you also have to work on those biases.
Yeah.
If you're patriarchal, then you have to work on those biases, and you have to be able to take a gendered perspective.
Yeah.
If you belong to a particular class and caste, then you have to know that, yes, acknowledge that, you know, you are privileged, but then it's not just enough to acknowledge that you're privileged, but you also have to find a way in which you can actually, you know, I mean, to make a conversation that, you know, I mean, that would be a conversation of adjacencies,
yeah,
with those who do not belong to your class and,
yeah,
caste, you know. So I think acknowledgement, yes, but the next step is also criticality and also what to do with that privilege,
yeah,
you know, because it's not just enough to say that, yes, I am privileged. Most of the people in this room are privileged. But I mean, I think that all our journeys that have taken us, whether through the digital sphere, through filmmaking, through drawing, has always been a way of not doing what all the things that you were meant to do, you know, which you were born with.
Yeah.
For me, that's very, very important.
Yeah.
You know, it's not about what you were born with, but it's about what you make of yourself. And if you go with that idea, then I think you will always be able to, you know, find some wavelength in which to talk to people who come from various locations, various cultures, various linguistic subjectivities.
Thank you.
Yes, please.
In today's time, would you say that the dividends among artists and practitioners of art to very, let's say, openly present their work and state their positionality, you know, like this, clearly, because of the atmosphere of restrictions, censorship that does prevail, particularly if you have a very forthright opinion. Therefore, I still feel that this online space is very discreet. Yeah, I mean, it's not, for example, like I've seen films made in the BFI, the British Film Institute, and that kind of, you know, views presented there, but you know, they were just argumentative, they were critical, they were absolutely, extremely forthright. So we don't have that courage yet, I feel, to put forward, you know, everything beyond art project in a very steady manner, and that's something that you feel safe with. You don't feel safe. So you have to circuit very often. Your artwork also changes, adapts very often, and we compromise without even, you know, we know it and we feel bad about it, but we do compromise here and there. But some, I mean, you're lucky that you've been able to do this kind of documentation, but perhaps because of the lack of a critical tradition that we have here generally, you know, we are not recognizing this critical politicization of political aspects to art. Many, many people know that. We are just sort of blandly taking it in and just see the visual without knowing the deeper aspects to it. It's just, so you were speaking, there's hardly any cogency in this kind of your work, in work generally, not your work, the artists should be coming forward and speaking more.
No, I think yes, definitely considering the atmosphere today, we have to keep fighting against these kinds of self-censorships that we impose upon ourselves, you know. So we have to find ways of working around these compromises and complicities that we encounter on a daily basis.
Yeah.
And we have to find other languages of communicating what we think, what we feel, what we support.
Yeah. Well, then, you know, the online news, like Wire and the Scroll, I mean,
yes,
they're two very prominent examples. I mean, they are still trudging through, but they are facing lack of funding, for instance. You know, they just cannot carry on with their work.
Yeah.
And no one is, and you know, they just don't have corporate backing.
Exactly.
I don't know, the artists may be also suffering that way, this lack of.
I don't think artists
that kind of attention, you know. No, but Roshan, thank you at the close of this to draw our attention to dangers outside and internal as well. There's overt censorship, there's also the kind of circumspection that people internalize at times like this.
Mm-hmm.
So all the more reason to demonstrate the kind of courage and rigor that we heard from both our speakers today. So thank you, both of you, and thank you all for being here this evening.
Thank you.